if you ask yourself, when we end the shiur last time, we deal with Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, it was just between Lag BaOmer and Shavuot, and we talked about the profile, the difference between Rabbi Shimon, the halachic person, and Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, the spiritual person, the one who everyone looked to feel close to him. And you ask yourself in the end of this meeting, what is my feeling about Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai? It's complicated. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai in the halachic world, the Rabbanim kept him not in the mainstream. They kept him in the side. They kept him, but not strongly. The tzibur, the people, hugged him much stronger. Now we moved from Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai to his close friend, the second Talmid of Rabbi Akiva. If you remember, I mentioned the first meeting that everyone said, I am the student of Rabbi Akiva, but Rabbi Akiva said just about two, that he grew them up, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai and Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes, just both of them. Why we called Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes, the miracle person, it's a different story. Maybe we will come to that. But first of all, listen carefully. When I'm talking about Rabbi Shimon, always we say Rashbi or Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. When we are talking about Rabbi Yuda, the first meeting, we spoke about Rabbi Yuda Bar Ilai. When we will maybe talk about Rabbi Yossi, so we say Rabbi Yossi Ben Chalafta. Each one of the Chachamim in this generation, each one of them come from background. They can count the family, the father name, and they said, I am the son of, except Rabbi Meir. Rabbi Meir, we don't know where he came from. Chachamim in the Gemara said that he converted. From the background was a big yichus from the Caesar, the Caesar of Rome named Neron. Neron was a very chashuv person who destroyed our temple. So yichus of Rabbi Meir, Gemara said, he came from Neron, Caesar. No. We have no other mekorot sources dealing with the family, the background of Rabbi Meir. This is the first sentence that I want to put here when we deal with this very, very unusual person. Second sentence, no one after him said, I am from his family. He is a lonely. He came to the world without background. He left the world alone and he brought a light, unusual light to the world, and his name, Meir. It's not, you know, it's very interesting. Today we use the name Yair. Okay, it's your road. On Yair, we said, no, it's not yours, it's Daniel's. So Barak, it's also light, nachon. So Yair, it's a future, nachon? Yair, will light. Meir, it's a present time. And I want to try to explain the figure, the character of Rabbi Meir, like a present time person, person that live in his time with the large, large light, with the close feeling to Hashem, put himself in his situations, in the dati, in the religious situations, very unusual. And in the end, he left the world exactly like he came, without stories. He came and left alone. This is the first two sentences about him. The third sentence will be a short story that I found in the Gemara. And I want to say that this short story it's like a symbol. It's like story who moved us to think about the, what Chazal, what sages said about him. And you can find the story in source number one. I made the decision this time. I will read the Hebrew version slowly, slowly. You have the ability to listen to my Hebrew and read the English. בסדר? אחלה. אחלה, it's a ממש Hebrew word. נכון. Okay, source number one. It comes from the Talmud Masechet Yevamot. אמר רבן גמליאל, פעם אחת הייתי מהלך בספינה וראיתי ספינה אחת שנשברה והייתי מצטער על תלמיד חכם שבא. ומי הוא? רבי עקיבא. וכשעליתי ביבשה בא וישב ודן לפניי בהלכה. אמרתי לו, בני, מי אלך? אמר לי, דף של ספינה נזדמן לי, וכל גל וגל שבא עליי, נענתי לו ראשי. מכאן אמרו חכמים, אם יבואו רשעים על אדם, ינענע לו ראשו. Second source, אמר רבי עקיבא, okay, it's the same source, but the second part, אמר רבי עקיבא, פעם אחת הייתי מהלך בספינה, וראיתי ספינה אחת שמתערפת בים, והייתי מצטער על תלמיד חכם שבא. ומי הוא? רבי מאיר. כשעליתי למדינת קפוטקיה, בא וישב, ודן לפניי בהלכה. אמרתי לו, בני, מי אלך? אמר לי, גל טרדני לחברו, וחברו לחברו, עד שהקיעני ליבשה. I'm not sure that these two short stories happened in the history. Maybe yes, maybe not. It's a, we have 1,000 stories in the Talmud. Some of them we can feel that it's true historical stories. Some we can show that it's fantasy. That story is, maybe yes, maybe not. But never mind. The people in the Gemara days who wrote or brought this story to the world tried to bring a message to us. And it's clear that the message is what between Rabbi Akiva and his super student, Rabbi Meir. Someone asked exactly the same question that I raised here just in the beginning of the lesson. What is the profile? What is the character of Rabbi Meir? And to understand that, someone in the Gemara put in contrast the story of Rabbi Akiva and Rabbi Meir. When Rabbi Akiva found himself in a dangerous situation in the ocean, he took the raf shel sfina, okay, wood, and he gave reshut, he gave right to the waves to bring him, to take him. He didn't fight. Rabbi Akiva didn't do anything aggressive. He just left. He just gave the waves reshut to take him until the end that he found himself on the beach, on the land. The opposite situation is with Rabbi Meir. Again, a dangerous situation. He found himself in the ocean. But instead, leave. Instead, give the waves reshut. He fought against, and each wave threw him to another. He fought himself in what we called ma'arbolet, מערבולת, you see the world, משהו, פול, בסדר. בסדר, מערבולת. בסדר, מערבולת. And in the end, he found himself on the land, but without peace, in a situation of war, fighting. And I think that this is a good example, maybe a symbol, maybe a way of Chazal trying to explain the differences. So I started with that to say that Rabbi Meir wasn't a simple person. Rabbi Meir fought against everyone. He was a person that believed by his own way. He knew clearly that his position is the real Torah, and he didn't accept the arguments. Now, if you remember from the second volume of Chachamim, you remember the profile of Rabbi Eliezer ben Horkenus. Rabbi Eliezer from the generation before, from Yavne period, Rabbi Eliezer, the Chevruta with Rabbi Yehoshua. Rabbi Eliezer was the person who found himself as a protector of the tradition. He said that he against every chidush in the Torah world. He didn't accept the creations in Yavne. He tried to keep the lessons that the old teachers brought him. He kept the words. He didn't change anything. Rabbi Yehoshua was the opposite. Now, Rabbi Meir wasn't like that. Rabbi Meir brought many, many chidushim to the world. But Rabbi Meir found himself, or thought about himself, that he touched, really, the real original Torah. If we, the whole Jews around the world, know quite well that we live without prophets, that we live after the days of Nevi'im, that we live with dilemmas, that we live in the Torah world with a question mark, that we're not sure that maybe it's the most important word in our religious life. Rabbi Meir didn't know what is question mark. He said a very strong sentences and was sure about his way. And we can found many, many examples to show this point about this person. The story that I brought in number two, again, story that I brought in number two, it's a different, completely different example. Maybe it's funny, maybe not. Maybe it's, again, story that people talked about Rabbi Meir. Maybe it didn't happen at all. But it's a way that I want to share with you something completely different, what we call byproduct. Not just to talk about Rabbi Meir, but to talk about the way how Chachamim brought messages to us via the stories. You know that until 30 years ago, maybe 40 years ago, the regular lomdim, people who learned Gemara, or sages, or Torah Shebe'al Peh, when they found themselves in what we call Agadeta, stories, legendas, and like that, people didn't care about that. It calls shtuyot. It's for women. It's not for us. Shtuyot. I need to be careful in Pardes or in the memorial of Larry. Stam, beseder. They wrote, you know, they wrote that this is not for us. It's for women. They thought that a serious Gemara, it's arguments, it's a law business, it's a logic, it's very complicated sources, but stories, they just move over. I remember, not 40 years ago, but 30 years ago, when we learned in the yeshiva, when we learned Masechet and we found ourselves in a story or Agada, so the rabbi said, okay, this you will learn alone in the Seder, alone, Chavruta, not in the Shiur. No one teach that. Not no one. Kimat. In the last generation, we found that the messages who came from these stories is unbelievable. The whole stories bring not just ideas of philosophy, not just backgrounds, not just historical facts, but it's bring the real feelings that Chachamim brought to us about moral values, about everything. And thanks God, today, after generation, when we find ourselves in stories, we stop and take it very seriously. Try to understand the message. So here is a story, come from Bereshit Rabbah. Again, I will do something differently. It's written in Aramaic, not just a regular Aramaic, but Aramaic from Eretz Israel, because Bereshit Rabbah, it's a book that edited in Eretz Israel in the Talmud days. And it's very, very difficult Aramaic, like Yerushalmi. So even the people who feel comfortable with the Babylonian Aramaic, this is harder. I will read it in Hebrew, and you will read it in it. So you listen, you can, you can read it in the Aramaic, and then listen to the Hebrew, and then to the English version. Beseder. Haboker Or. Okay, Haboker Or, Bereshit Rabbah, as Midrash, it always took the Pasuk, started with Pasuk, and then bring the story or something like. Haboker Or, Pasuk, if you remember, when the whole brothers of Yosef went from Egypt back home. Haboker Or ve'anashim yatzu hema v'chamorehem. Okay, when they wake up in the morning, they left Egypt. This is the Pasuk that the Midrash brought the story on that. Amar Rabbi Levi. Rabbi Levi was a sage in the 3rd century. Haya ma'aseh. But Darom, when stories beginning with stories about Darom, first of all, you should know, Darom in the Talmud days, it's not Sinai, even not Be'er Sheva. Darom is Lod. Lod is Darom. And it was, I don't want to say kacha seriously, but it was very danger area. Okay, Shchunat HaRakevet, if you know that. Okay, very danger area. Many, many criminals in Lod in those days. When people went to Darom, south from the Galil, they didn't feel comfortable. It's enough, okay? So, מעשה היה בדרום שהיה שם פונדק, it's like motel, it's a place that you, it's like a bed and breakfast, okay, like motel, בסדר? חד פונדקאי. And this person, the master of this motel, he wore his clothes in the evening, and he said to the guests in the middle of the night, he waked up the guests and told them, hurry, go out because the caravan is away. And you know that in this area, no one allow to go alone. You have a group now, so hurry. Go out and leave the motel. This is your chance to find a group. And they, of course, the whole guests, jump and went out. And when they start moving from the motel, a robbers jump on them. The English version said that they killed them. I think that they just robbed them. So they jump on them and took the whole money. And they had a nice deal. The master of the motel had half, and they took half. That was the regular business in this area. Okay. One day, Rabbi Meir found himself in this guest house. Of course, he didn't know that this is the rules in this area. And he found himself, you know, check in. He took his room and went to sleep. Midnight, the master start his regular tafkid, shout, everyone, the caravan is go. You should go. You should leave. Everyone jumped except Rabbi Meir. Rabbi Meir slept. So the master came to him and said, why you don't go? So Rabbi Meir answered to him, I'm waiting, I have a brother. I told you that he was a lonely person. Here he said, I have a brother, and I wait to my brother. Where is your brother? The master asked. He said, he's in the synagogue, Lod, you know. Even in Lod, they had synagogue. Okay, so he went to the synagogue, Tikkun Chatzot, I don't know, he went to do something at night in the synagogue. Okay, I will call him, said the master. Stay here, prepare yourself, and I will bring him. So he went to the synagogue, he saw a synagogue with doors closed, and he shouted. I forget something. He asked him, what's the name of your brother? So he said, the name? Kitov. Kitov is the Roman name. So, Kitov. Now, what is Kitov in Hebrew? Kitov. Vayar Elohim et haor Kitov. Okay. So he said, the name of my brother, Kitov. Excellent. So the master went to the synagogue and, you know, screamed, Kitov, Kitov. No one answered. You know, the synagogue was empty. Kitov, Kitov, call Alayla. The whole night, the master shout, Kitov. In the morning, he returned back to the guest house. And so Rabbi Meir prepared himself with the donkey to continue the way, you know, over the night over. Where is your brother? Asked the master. And I moved the page. I turned the page. You know, when I hear myself say mistake, it's also a ma'ala, nachon? Okay. Where is your brother? So Rabbi Meir said, here. He showed him the son and said, this is my brother. Shene'emar, Vayar Elohim et haor ki tov. This is the story. Now, haya or lo haya, who care? Lemi echpat shtuyot. You can ask this question in the academy. The lo ma'anyen, no one interesting about the historical situation. We understand that someone named Rabbi Levi in the third century, mean about 150 years after Rabbi Meir, brought this story about Rabbi Meir and what he tried to say. First of all, Rabbi Meir didn't have brother. His brother was the son. Mean what? He was a person who lived with the natural, with the world. He went after his feelings. He listened carefully to his feelings, to his own feelings, and maybe to the voice of Hashem. I don't want to say that Rabbi Meir was a prophet. He wasn't a prophet. And I will show you that he wasn't a prophet. But we have so many, not just stories, but also also discussions, arguments between Rabbi Meir and his partners, that he brought the shita, the idea he brought from himself. He didn't look after mekorot. You know, I can prove, I can show that I'm right. No, he said, I know that I am right. He felt that he is correct. He went, he walked after his feelings. And his son, I have a son, okay? The son was his brother. I feel close to Hashem. If you want to see it in a different way, unbelievable sentence that I found again in Bereshit Rabbah. You know that when we read the first chapter in Sefer Bereshit, the first chapter in Sefer Bereshit, so we know after the Adam and Adam and Chava, Adam and Eve, after the story of the head, the sin in Gan Eden, Hashem told them to wear clothes. נכון? ויעש השם אלוקים לאדם ולאשתו, Hashem prepared them what? כותנות אור. אור is leather. כותנות אור with עין. The Midrash said in number 3, בתורתו של רבי מאיר, mean when we open the Sefer Torah, the real Sefer Torah of Rabbi Meir, we found מצאו כתוב כותנות אור with Aleph, a light clothes, כותנות אור. Now you should understand the it's unbelievable. First of all, you know the briskers here will ask halachic questions. It's kosher or posel, you know? What the status of Sefer Torah of Rabbi Meir? But you understand that the Midrash doesn't care about that. He tried to brought a message about Rabbi Meir because the or it's something who make separation between what's happened inside your soul and the world. It's like a separation. This is the whole tafkid of the skin. You made something to make a distance. Rabbi Meir didn't wear these clothes. Rabbi Meir felt comfortable with his light. He went immediately inside the inyan, the essence about itself. He didn't care. He didn't afraid about that. He felt comfortable. Kotnot or with Aleph. Because that, the Gemara said in source number 4, אמר רבי אחא בר חנינא, גלוי וידוע. Okay, again, it's in Hebrew. I will read it very, very slowly. אמר רבי אחא בר חנינא, number 4, גלוי וידוע לפני מי שאמר והיה העולם, שאין בדורו של רבי מאיר כמותו. ומפני מה? לא קבעו הלכה כמותו. I will stop in a minute, for a minute here. First of all, it's a, you know, it's not a question. It's a fact. The fact that written in Gemara, in Masechet Eruvin, that everyone in the Gemara world, in the sages world, everyone know that halakha is not, we not follow Rabbi Meir Shita. It's clear. Last time we said it about Rabbi Shimon. Now the second Talmid of Rabbi Akiva, we said no, we don't follow his shita. En halacha kmoto. And everyone in the world know that he is number 1 in Beit HaMidrash. And even one person in this generation that can fight against him in the gadlut, in the heroism of Limud Torah. He is number 1. but we will not follow his steps.
Why?
The answer, שלא יכלו חבריו לעמוד על סוף דעתו. His light was too strong for us. We couldn't live with him. We couldn't stay close to him because whom lesanver when the light is too strong.
Blinded?
Me'aver? Wow. Today is the day of the blinded, you know? וואו, לא חשבתי על זה. Blind, מעניין, לעבר. In Hebrew, it's a very nice difference between עיוור ולסנוור. לסנוור, that you have full light and you can't see. So, actually, you are a person that you have the ability to see, but not in such light. Okay? זה לסנוור, רבי מאיר, was a person with full light, so no one can stay close to him. It was too much even to the chachamim. So what we should say, lo yachlu chaverav la'amod al sof da'ato. It was too much. Shu omer al tameh tahor mar'eh lo panim. He see a situation, any situation. It can be kashrut, it can be Shabbat, it can be any situation that you want to raise in the halachic world, he look and say, yeah, I see the opposite. Why? You know what the answer is? In Hashem world, not in our world, in Hashem world, there is no differences between Tameh and Tahor. There is one world, Hashem Echad, Shmo Echad, it's one world that Hashem lived in. We separate the world. Ata chonentanu, you remember? Ata chonentalu vatelamdenu lehavdil. You taught us to separate the world between days and Shabbat, between Tameh and Tahor, between Mutar and Asur. We make the separations, not Hashem. In Hashem world, you can find, in every situation, you can see the whole sides. It's just one story with many, many options. Zachor v'shamor, if you want. Bedibur echad ne'emru. It's not machlok, it's not argument between Zachor and Shamor. It's one. Toda. And the truth is that when we learn, I know nothing at all about Kabbalah. Bemet, nothing at all. But the regular ideas that we got from the Kabbalah world is exactly that. That the world of Hashem is a complete world. And then something broken. And we live in the broken world. If you want to take it easily, we can speak about luchot rishonim veluchot shniim. You know, the Torah that Moshe got first time and second time. So Rabbi Meir found himself like Moshe Rabbeinu with the first luchot. And we live with the second, luchot shvurim. It's very hard to say that. But Rabbi Meir was a person like that. He felt that he doesn't need limited borders. He didn't need a skin. He felt that he's so close to Hashem. He's so close to the original Torah. That was his deep feeling. That he didn't see any problems to see something impure and say, yes, it's pure, and the opposite. And Chachamim said, it's not our world. Jump to the last part in source number 4. Okay, I'm still in source number 4, but the last part, starting with the words Rabbi declared. So Rabbi mean Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi. Rabbi Yehuda HaNasih, the president in the end of the Mishnah days, just one generation after Rabbi Meir. If Rabbi Meir lived between 100, 150, Rabbi Yehuda HaNasih was baby when Rabbi Meir was old man. Okay? Something like that. Amar Rabbi. Okay? Rabbi declared. In Hebrew. Again, it's a remake. I will move it to Hebrew. Hasiba she'ani charif yoter me'achaverim sheli hirak biglal שראיתי את רבי מאיר מאחור. אילו הייתי רואה אותו מלפנים, הייתי חריף הרבה יותר. שכתוב, והיו עיניך רואות את מורך. I want to argue with these words. Not with the whole words, just the end, the last words. What he said, what Rabbi Yehuda HaNasih said here, he said, I was a baby, or maybe a very young child, and I came to the yeshiva, to the class. My father, Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel, brought me to see the hero, you know, the Chacham Rabbi Meir. He brought me to the yeshiva, and I was so little, and I saw Rabbi Meir from his back. I didn't see his face, but I was moved from that, and I become a brilliant, much more than all my friends who didn't have the privilege to see Rabbi Meir from his back. And now, said Rabbi Yehuda HaNasih, just think what will happen if I had the chance to see Rabbi Meir in front, where it put me. That is the feelings of Rabbi Yehuda HaNasih. The end is, שנאמר, והיו עיניך, your eyes should see, should watch your teacher. And I think that it's the end of this pasuk, it's terrible, it's a big mistake. Because if I had the privilege to write this piece, it's in the Gemara. If I had the privilege to write it, I will end like that. שנאמר, someone want to play with me? You're afraid. Someone? Rav Daniel. שנאמר, וראיתם את אחוריי ופניי לא יראו. I can swear that that is the correct perush to this source. I promised me, I can swear. I know like Rabbi Meir in you. You know, to say such thing, I saw him from his back and not from his face, it's to say, for me, he is like the image of God. Maybe not image of God, but maybe itself. I couldn't see his face because his light was too much for us. So we watched from the back and not from the front. שנאמר וראיתם את אחוריי ופניי לא יראו. Maybe Moshe Rabbeinu, who went down from the mountain with the cover his face because his light, קרן אור פניו. Okay? So you understand the feelings that one generation after Rabbi Meir, what people talked about him, he was much higher, large light, but we couldn't keep him in our regular poor world of halachic business. Halacha lo tiye kmoto. The Gemara in Masechet Brachot, I know what's happened to me. Beseder. Ma anachnu osim, you know? Marsha, I made a decision, or we'll do it like that. I will continue now with Rab Meir, because the coming sources, first of all, dealing about himself, then about the relationship between him and Rabbi Elisha ben Avuya, or what we called Acher, the other, and in the end I put also the relationship between him and Bruria, his wife. So next time, instead talking about Rabbi Yossi, the modern Orthodox Rebbe in the sages' days, we will talk about Bruria and Rabbi Meir. Okay, so we changed the subject for the next time, and now I have relaxed to continue easily. Seder? Zeu. We made the decision. So in source number 5, in source number 5 and 6, for number 5 and 6, I just brought a text from the Gemara and Rambam to explain what is the category who put person in the status of Ohev Hashem. You know, everyone say Ahavat Hashem, Ahavat Hashem, Ahavat Hashem, love Hashem, to love God. But you should have something as a category who said what you need to do to be in this category of Ohev Hashem. And Rabbi Meir, Margela number 5, it was a very regular sentence, very regular sentence that Rabbi Meir used to say, and then he wrote a poem. Number 5, actually, I didn't read the English version, but in Hebrew, it's a poem that Rabbi Meir wrote about feel close with all your soul, your body, your feelings, everything you need to feel to Hashem. Gmor bechol levavcha ubechol nafshecha לדעת את דרכי, לשקוד על דלתי תורתי, נצור תורתי בלבך, נגד עיניך תהיה יראתי, שמור פיך מכל חטא, תהר, קדש עצמך מכל אשמה ואבון, ואני, the last sentence, ואני אהיה איתך בכל מקום. If you ask Rambam, what kind of style, of category, Rabbi Meir brought, Rabbi Meir will say, you know something about relationship between men and women? This is Ahava. Rabbi Meir loved Hashem like Ahava shel Ish Veisha. And Rabbi Meir, when he tried to, Rambam, when he tried to explain us in Sefer Mishneh Torah, in his book, in Hilchot Tshuva, what is the category of Ahavat Hashem? He took the words from Rabbi Meir. Rabbi Meir was Ohev Hashem. He, all his life, all his feelings, all his motivations, all his desires, everything moved to Hashem. But sometimes when you bring such light to the world, it can become so dangerous, and it's bring you not just to a difficult situation, not just to a dangerous situation, but it throw you out from your home or from your regular place. And that's what happened to Rabbi Meir twice. One with his teacher, Elisha ben Avuya, and second time with his wife, Bruria. Very, very upset stories. Today, we will deal just with source number 7 about the relationship between Rabbi Meir and Elisha ben Avuya. 60 seconds about Elisha, Acher the other. Elisha was and still, I think, in the Jewish thoughts, the typical apikores in the world, in the Jewish world. If you want to put someone in a status of Epicurus, Epicurus mean that you was in the past Talmid Chacham, part of the club, part of the people who learned and know quite well the Torah, and then you threw everything and you keep your life without any connection with Hashem. You left the world of Hashem and the Torah. And the typical person was Elisha ben Avuya. You know that we had in Israel, in the last generation, a judge named Chaim Cohen. Was one of the famous judges in Israel, Chaim Cohen. And he said about himself, I think that I'm close to Elisha ben Avuya. He was Talmid Chacham, Gadol. Behemet, he was one of the best Talmidei Chachamim in the Jewish world, and he threw everything, including his kehuna, and become Epicurus. He said it about himself. Not every idiot can be Epicurus. To be Epicurus, you need to be a chashuv person. Elisha ben Avuya was Epicurus. Okay. So in the Gemara, we have two pages dealing with Elisha ben Avuya. It's Bavli, Yerushalmi, Midrash. We have many, many stories about Elisha ben Avuya. I brought here small piece. Tanu Rabbanan. Number 7, Ma'aseh. Be'acher. How they translate Acher? Acher, okay. Okay, Acher. Shehaya, the other should be. Shehaya rochev al asus b'shabbat. Vahaya Rabbi Meir mehalech acharav lilmod Torah mipiv. Now you see the situation? I see the old students. Rabbi Meir learned in Bnei Brak. Be'emet, in Bnei Brak, with Rabbi Akiva. You see the students in Bnei Brak near Ponevesh, see the teacher Elisha ben Avuya driving, and Rabbi Meir run next to him to learn Torah. Shabbat. Amar lo, מאיר, חזור לאחריך שכבר שיערתי בעקבי הסוס עד כאן תחום שבת. It's unbelievable. You know, this is a real Epicurus. I don't care, but in your shita you should stop. Now what's happened? Again, what's happened to Rabbi Meir? He moved after his Torah. For him, Elisha ben Avuya is just klipa. It's a klipa? Shell or so, a different world I look. So the klipa, it's just outside. It's not the real. Elisha, Mechalel Shabbat, Elisha, Epicurus, who cares? I know that inside this person, something real kept the real Torah. Rabbi Elisha ben Avuya learned from Rabbi Yochanan, from Rabbi Yoshua. He kept the original Torah. And I want to take this Torah from him. He doesn't care about the horse, about the Tchum Shah. He didn't think about Alpaim Amma. If you ask Rabbi Meir, what do you think? We allow to move over Shabbat more than 2,000 Amma? He will say, Chas v'chalila, Isu deoraita. Rabbi Meir was a halachic person. But when he learned with Elisha ben Avuya, he forgot his limited. He broke it. And he moved. And Elisha knew his student quite well. Say, listen, darling, stop here. For you, it's enough. We moved too much. And then he cried and said to his teacher, please, you should return also with me. And to return, it's not return physically. Return to Beit HaMidrash. And then the very known answer that Elisha ben Avuya brought and said, listen, darling, I heard from the real world, מאחורי הפרגוד, שובו בנים שובבים חוץ מאחר. The whole Jewish people had the chance to return back except the real Epicurus, me, Acher. The gate closed for me. I will not deal about Elisha ben Avuya now. I want to continue the Gemara. Okay, so now you find it in the English version, the continue. אשכחי רבא בר שילא לאליהו. רבא בר שילא met אליהו the prophet. You can find it? Please find it, the it's in the middle of the number 7. בסדר, מצאתם את זה? אוקיי. So רבא בר שילא is one of the Aramaic sages from the 4th century, 200 years after Rabbi Meir. Okay, 200 years later. And he suddenly walked on the road and found friends. Who was his friend? Eliyahu. Alan. How are you, Eliyahu? You know, regular meeting. A man with the prophet Eliyahu from Hashem world. So he said to him, Amar lo, can you tell me ma ka'avid, ma ose ha-kadosh baruch hu? Now look carefully, because in Aramaic it's written, mai ka'avid. The translation should be, I didn't see the English, should be in the present time. Bseder, it's written, I can't find it. The, ma? Oy vavoy. Oy oy oy. So I will say it in Aramaic, Hebrew, and English. Bseder? Okay. So it's in the middle of this source. He asked Kutshab, he asked Eliyahu, okay, the Chacham, the sage, ask Eliyahu, can you tell me what exactly Hashem do right now? Right now. Can you open, you know, with your machine, can you open the window of Hashem world and show me right now what Hashem doing? Of course I can tell you what you're supposed to, what Hashem's supposed to do in the Bavel world, in the Chachamim world. Do you know? In the sages, specific in the Bavli world, everyone, include everyone, I'm not sure about the women, sorry, but everyone do just, all the time, just one thing. Learning Torah. Learning Torah day and night, Shabbat, and all the time. And Hashem include everyone. So if you ask me what Hashem doing now, he's in the middle of Shiur. Now it's Shiur Kloli of Hashem. Hashem in his yeshiva, up there, he had all his students, Avraham, Yitzchak, Yaakov, you know, all the students sit, and Hashem bring a nice Shiur now. And, said Eliyahu the prophet, Hashem brought sources from the whole sages. You should remember, we are now in the 4th century. Okay, in the Aramaic days. Now, he returned back and said, in the Shiur Hashem bring, now, Hashem bring the whole Torah that he learned from the Tanaim, from the sages in the Tanaim, in the Mishnah days. All of them except one. He doesn't mention one person. Rabbi Meir. Hashem didn't want to use Rabbi Meir Torah. Rabba, the Chacham, was shocked. Said, why? Rabbi Meir, the light of the world. Hashem didn't use his Torah. So Eliyahu answered, of course. Because Rabbi Meir used, in his Torah, he used the Torah from Acher, from Elisha ben Avuya. So the Chacham argued against Eliyahu, against Hashem, and said, but we know that Rabbi Meir was a person who took the inside and threw the outside. Taklipot. He threw out.
He took the pureness. He didn't touch the whole bad things from Elisha ben Avuya. We know the stories about Rabbi Meir. And then the Gemara said that Eliyahu stopped him and said, sorry, I hear just now, in this moment, that Hashem, during the shiur, Hashem bring Torah from Rabbi Meir. He heard you, and he bring Rabbi Meir Torah. And the Torah was terrible. The Torah was, בזמן שאדם מצטער, when a person is in a very illness situation, bad, sad situation, what the Shekhinah, what in the world of Hashem, what the echo, what the reaction that Hashem reacted to the bad feelings, to the sad feelings of a person. מה לשון אומרת? קלני מראשי, קלני מזרועי. When sad stories happen to people, Hashem cried with them. And the end of the shiur is, אם כך הקדוש ברוך הוא מצטער על דמם של רשעים, קל וחומר על דמם של צדיקים שנשפך. Now to explain that, we need the whole evening. About the relationship, about the crying that Hashem cried when he brought the Torah of Rabbi Meir. But you can feel close here that they had a dilemma. What to do with the Torah that they got from Rabbi Meir? It's acceptable or it's too much? It's bring inside problematic situations or thoughts. So in this piece of Gemara, Chachamim brought this dilemma to Eliyahu Hanavi world, to Hashem world, and they end it with the well feeling that Rabbi Meir was the only one who knew how to play, how to take the pure from the inside and to throw out the whole klipot, the whole negative things. And what we did, since then until today, with Rabbi Meir, it's unbelievable. For example, Chazal said in the Gemara that if you open Mishnah, Stam Mishnah, without name, you should believe that Stam Mishnah, Rabbi Meir. So even though we said that we will not follow his steps because his light was too strong for us, we have hundreds Mishnayot, and you know that halakha follow from the Mishnah, and you have Stam Mishnah, so halakha ki Stam Mishnah. And Stam Mishnah is Rabbi Meir. So in the end, it's a very simple math, okay? If halakha ki Stam Mishnah, and Stam Mishnah Rabbi Meir, so in the end we understand it's a very simple logic, nachon? So we use the halakha from Rabbi Meir. So we loop the problematic solution that we say we will not follow his steps. We do. But we will never say it, we follow Rabbi Meir's steps. We follow the Mishnah steps, Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi. But he took the Torah from Rabbi Meir and he saw just his back. Just think what's happened if you will see his face. We will continue with Bruria next time.